Well, I was living in Colorado Springs at the time, and I became friends with a guy named Charlie Kestis, and he was huge into comics. We were actually, we met and became friends because we loved movies, and so we ended up going to movies all the time. So became very big friends, and we were trying to get as many movies on video as we could. Just huge movie fans, but he was also a comic book fan. So when he showed me, this would have been the mid to late 80s, he was showing me what comic books were doing. And I'd always been an artist from the first time I could remember. As soon as I could hold a crayon, I drew and told stories. So always a storyteller, always an artist. So it was very exciting when he showed me what was going on. Mage, the first Grendel series. So Matt Wagner was a big influence on me and is now one of my best friends. The Mr. X series, the four issues done by the Hernandez brothers, which turned me on to Love and Rockets. At that time, Dark Knight Returns had come out. So there were all these really exciting formats, everything from the black and white magazine format of Love and Rockets to the prestige format of Dark Knight. Graphic novels became a new phrase. So it was really easy to be seduced by comic books again. And being a movie nut, I had aspirations to be a screenwriter and a director, and had wrote a screenplay called Dead Air. So when I thought about drawing my own comic, it was easy to just draw my screenplay. And I did. I didn't know anything about submitting things, so I actually drew. I had a 100-page graphic novel drawn before it was published, or before it was solicited. We were picked up by Slave Labor Graphics when I was living in Europe. They wanted to publish it, so bang, graphic novel. By the time that came out, I had wanted to improve myself. So I had drawn 48 pages of material. So Slave Labor offered to do a 48-page book, and it was called Graphique Musique. And then when we moved back to the States, after three issues of Graphique Musique, I started what became four issues of Graphic Music, a phonetically spelled version of this umbrella title, which allowed me to experiment with storytelling. And from there, I illustrated a series for Dark Horse called Tales of Ordinary Madness, where I really experimented with brush strokes and just wanted to loosen myself up as an artist because I felt my work was kind of stiff. And at around that same time period, I had the idea for Madman, using a character from Graphic Music and a one-shot called Creatures of the Id. My favorite character's name was Frank Einstein. And so when Tundra was interested in that, Kevin Eastman's company, he just picked it up. So it did well. And then when he stopped publishing, I had Mike Richardson asking me if I'd take it to Dark Horse, and it's been there ever since.
Go to one because, you know, I'm from Calgary, Alberta, and there's nothing there. So this is the big convention I go to, and that's it. And it's cool down here. Everyone's here. The editors are here. The publishers are here. I don't know. The editors aren't really looking to hire people. They're more looking to critique you and to help you get hired. But when they're doing a portfolio review, they're not, you know, I'm gonna find someone to hire because I want someone to do this book. They're more like, these kids keep coming to me. I've got to help them out as much as I can.
I'm coming here strictly to get a job. It's nice to have a vacation, obviously, from the 12-hour shift stuff and all, but we've put a lot of work into the series, and it's not enough just to get looked at. I've got to get the series sold and get some kind of commitment on it and get it going and actually go somewhere, finally.
I've seen the book, I've seen all the exhibits, all the displays, all the seminars that's going on, and amongst all that, and tens of thousands of people, I've got to try and show my stuff to a small group of editors from each comic company over 4 days and see what they see. I've seen other artists already with their portfolios down there, and I look at them and think, oh great, more competition. How will I fare against these people? So I'm nervous about it, but you just try and put that out of the way. Just go. First and foremost is I want to have a good time. I want to meet the people I've read 3 years. I want to get my stuff looked at, and I want to see what they think of my stuff and if I've got a chance. That's probably the most nervous thing, is getting someone's sort of feedback. People that have been in the industry for years and years and years. If they give you the thumbs up, then it's a nice boost, a nice pat on the back, and there's hope for me in making it in the industry.
When I go down there, I'm hoping to meet every single famous artist that has ever inspired me. I had to talk with them for a little bit, show my portfolio around, see what people think of my art so far. I'd really like it, a like nice, harsh, realistic view, like a whole grill. Unappealing as that sounds, I'm hoping for the truth as soon as possible so I can change whatever I can to make my outlook look better.
The main reason why I went down to San Diego is, like everybody else seemed like, get a job or at least just get noticed or someone would, pay attention, right? Get something set up besides a form letter for all the work I do. Got to go to a convention down in the U.S., so I basically picked the biggest one that I ever heard of.
It's the biggest convention in the world, and it is the place to go if you're looking for someone to look at you. Competition down there is fierce. There must be thousands upon thousands of kids looking for work, and it doesn't stop there. I myself, obviously not a kid, but there's a lot of people my age as well who are down there looking for work too.
Just look at my damn stuff and tell me what you think so I can go to someone else that I really care about.
Tell you a little story. I met Neil Gaiman. He met Wagner, who ended up moving to Oregon. That's how we got to be friends. He turned Neil Gaiman onto my stuff, and Neil was looking for different artists to do Sandman. And this was right when Sandman was breaking big. Rolling Stone did a big article on comic books. He called me up and said, "Hey, want to do Sandman?" And I was like, "You're kidding." I just barely started doing comics full time, and thought, this is it. I've got it made. I'm going to be in this huge popular series. It was really exploding in popularity at the time. It was, I think, issue number 14 or something. That's how early on I had been asked to do this. Well, I thought it was a done deal, because I said, you bet. Well, it turns out I had to do submission pages, and the editor didn't like my stuff. Didn't think I was ready, turned me down. Got my hopes as high as you can imagine, and then, like, within days, completely shattered, destroyed. And Laura and told me, you know, you're better than that. Just do your own stuff. I had to do my own stuff in order to continue, in order to, you know, maintain some kind of value of my for myself. And that's what I became successful at. And it, so it was never about doing a Green Lantern series or a Spider-Man series or trying to get a job from people who in most cases, not all cases, but in most cases, don't even know good work when they see it. You know, I have seen portfolio reviews. I've, you know, been doing a signing and somebody over there is reviewing somebody's portfolio and it could be phenomenal work. And they'll start coming up with these cliche criticisms and that person will go away and the next person will come up, they'll tell them the exact same thing. Study anatomy, study perspective. They're not even looking at it. They're not even seeing how unique it is or anything. So, and again, these are people who are most likely hired to either be assistants or editorial people who probably couldn't draw a stick figure. And here they are giving advice to artists and aspiring artists. Doesn't make any sense. So listen, because a lot of them do have valid advice, but never let anyone's criticism, constructive or not, sway you from doing what you want to do. Don't let, even if it's somebody you really admire, if they don't like your stuff, move on, you know? You, if you like your stuff, and you become your worst critic, your harshest critic, that way you can judge your own growth. But never let somebody else, especially when you don't know them from nobody, never let their position stop your progress. You know, you can always go around or just go the other direction. But that almost stopped me cold in my tracks. And thank goodness it didn't. And I since did an issue of Sandman. And in this case, the editor who nixed me was right. I had a lot of room to improve. But instead of just going, I quit, because of Laura's support, I wish I could say because I'm a strong person, because Laura really was my cheerleader, I wanted to prove that I was good. And I just worked that much harder, studied that much more, practiced that much more, drew that much more, and eventually went past my original goals. So you gotta always be your biggest fan and your most harsh critic. So, that anyway, that was a little pet peeve of mine.
I always drew. I was an artist, and at first it was just I wanted to draw something. I wasn't thinking about writing, or although myself I did my own cartoons or whatever, but I just really wanted to draw anything. Draw the X-Men, draw Spider-Man, draw Daredevil. After high school I wanted to go to art school. I thought about college and also the Joe Kubert school. And it just was impossible. I was on my own time. Didn't have money to do that. So I basically just sat down at the drawing board and just drew my head off. And I had a job in a newspaper doing ad layout. And I was doing that and working on my portfolio. And I was, at the time I was going out with Maria, who became my wife. And, we got engaged to be married, and I figured we were going to be married in a year. So I figured now is the time. I better take my shot at doing comics. Now I'm going to be doing ad layout in a crappy local newspaper. Maybe move up to a little bit bigger, crappy newspaper. I quit my job at that point, and I would just sit down at the drawing board and just work on. I do like these little 6-page stories of whatever, Submariner and Thor and whoever. And then Maria would, photocopy them all, and we would write my name and address on the back of each one, and we would send them to all the different editors, Marvel and DC, and all the independent companies at the time. And then I would go do another 6 pages, and we would send them out again. And I went on a couple interviews up at Marvel. I met some really stupid people, and there was one editor, I don't even remember his name. I met him and he liked my work and he gave me some tips to work on, and then I went back and I improved and I came back and he gave me some more things and I came back and finally came back and he really liked the pages. He's like, well, pages are really good, but I don't have any work for you. What was I coming back to you for? You know, you have me coming back and just, you just, when people give you a critique, you get this feeling that, oh, okay, I just need to get a little bit better and then I'm in. So it was like very frustrating, and it took me almost a year of that being my full-time job, trying to break into comics. And I was getting like really surly, and it's just getting close to that wedding date, which is like my artificial deadline. And then like 3 weeks before I was gonna get married, I got a call from Valiant Comics. And I just started traveling up to New York, commuting to New York every day on the bus. And I went up there and I just learned from those guys, and I got better and started doing real work, and just, I was in.
I started sending off samples to the editors, and there's like literally 50 editors out there. They don't all have to like you. You only got to find one editor to like you. So once you send off the sample, then it's really cool because you get like 49 of them reject you, and then one guy go, yeah, okay. So, and given that there are multiple editors, even at like Marvel comic books in DC, then I would get like one letter, I'd open up and I'd say, you suck, you're not good enough to work for Marvel Comics. And then the next one goes, hey, you're pretty good, why don't you want to do 10 pages for us? So, you know, the guy on that side of the company hated me and that guy. So you just, all you gotta do is find one guy. So for the young aspiring artist, just keep pounding the pavement and do it. What we're doing, we're trying to conquer the world. So we're trying to become a frog in mom's pants with this character that she's probably not going to be too impressed with. But it's just because it's not cute and cuddly, and you're not going to see it on bed sheets, and you're not going to be able to buy like nice little glow-in-the-dark toothbrushes of him. And it's something that's more for the Generation X MTV crowd. You know, so it's for the people out there that get old enough that they want to basically start buying their own clothes and their own entertainment and listen to their own music, and they don't really want mom to start buying those kinds of things for them. So when you're 8, that's okay if mom brings home, you know, your back to school clothes. But when you're like 17, you know, you just give me the money, mom, or I'll go get a job and I'll go buy my own clothing and I'll take care of myself and I'm becoming an individual. So Spawn's really for that each of us from 7 to 70 that's like goes, ah, it's just ours, you know? And then it bugs the mom, makes it even cooler. I'm telling you. We sold worldwide over 100 million copies. I mean, we're huge in a lot of countries, but I mean, even bigger. We get bigger sales in some countries than we do actually like here. So big in Japan, you know, they love it, but you know, they don't have the censorship issues that we have here, and moms aren't nearly quite as uptight. But you know, it's just good, clean fun. No big deal. You never lose. Matter of fact, I got my Canadian underwear. See that? So we're proud to be Canadian, right? So we're doing good.
so rare to watch a movie and not know how it's going to end. That's what I want Mad Men to be like. I want when people see a Mad Men film, even if they have perceptions of a comic book movie, it's just going to blow the perceptions out of the water. They'll just have no idea. You know, it's got to be unique. It has to be exciting. And that's the very slow, careful path that we're taking on it. It's not about making action figures and, you know, cups at Taco Bell and, you know, how many movie theaters does it open in. You know, who cares? Most of the people who care about that stuff don't give a damn about art or the artist for one millisecond.
You see it in that one?
I did, and that's a great example of that. I do think there was an amazing amount of talent involved there. And I think George Clooney is just perfect to play Batman. But from the first film, just the design of the costume has just been horrible. Batman is a guy who's fine-tuned his body, and we don't... He cloaks himself in a cape. We don't even need to see all that rubber armored suit. He should be in the shadows. We don't even have to ever see his body. But when you see Batman moving like this because he can't move his neck, it's right from the first frame. It's embarrassing. It's wrong. So as good as any of the films have or haven't been, that aspect alone was just a bad idea to begin with. He has to be fast, and not fast from camera work or editing, but fast because he can be fast. He's agile. And, yeah, this armor thing, what is that about? Good movies can be made from comic books. They have been. Rocketeer, I thought, was very faithful. Near perfect version of the comic book. And it did well, but not as well as I think it should have. It was a real great example of what a comic book to film can be. The Crow, in the most tragic, haunting, mirrored way, is a great comic book movie. I think it surpassed the comic book, actually. You're watching a ghost play a ghost. It was really haunting, and Brandon Lee was just amazing in that film. So there's a great example of a comic book film. I mean, it can be done. By announcing its advancement, its option into the film world, I didn't realize how much anticipation that would create. I didn't realize that would be this major issue. Like, where is it? What's being done with it? And it's very important to me that if a film is indeed made, that it's as great as it can be. And I've been lucky the main producer on it is Ben Myron. He produced a film called One False Move, which was why I wanted to meet him in the first place. He has been fantastic. He's been really considerate and aware, very sensitive of how I feel about things, that the story has to be great. I wrote the first draft of the screenplay, and a very talented screenwriter named Dean Lowry did a polish on it that's just, he saw stuff I didn't see, and it's great. We're in love with the script. That's really what's taken as long as it has so far. So it's taken almost 2 years to get this far with it.
Got a devil's haircut in my mind. Got a devil's haircut in my mind. Got a devil's haircut.
Where's Mosier?
Scott, look at that shirt. Tremendous, dude. I'm a huge Canada fan. How could you see that shirt?
Where?
How come you don't have as much fucking pride in Canada as this dude? Canada kicks ass. Yeah.
catching a ride with the bleeding noses coming to town.
Why comics? Why not? You know, I mean, comics is the medium I'd much prefer to be in rather than film. And if I could draw, if I can draw worth a lick, I'd do it. That's what I'd do for a living. I mean, it doesn't pay as much, but still, God, it would be gratifying. So, I don't know, I've just always been a fan, you know? It's like, I respect the stories that are told. And just because they're told in pictures as well as words doesn't mean they deserve less respect or something. They just, they kind of get ghettoized in this country.
Baby got an atom bomb, a motherfucking atom bomb, between two megatons.
Hi, my name is Julie Strain. I'm queen of the B-movies. Penthouse Pet of the Year for 1993, and I'm married to Kevin Eastman, who owns Heavy Metal Magazine, and he's the co-creator for the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. And I've done about 90 movies. I'm most famous for my Andy Sedaris movies, where I headbutt people, blow up helicopters, spit on people, steal the money, and do some kickboxing and stuff like that. But now we're working on an animated movie called Heavy Metal Fact 2, and that's F-A-K-K-2. And you will see that movie in 1999. It's a large theatrical, big budget movie, and I'm gonna rock your world. Well, I became part of the comic book world through a lot of very hard work. I laid a lot of groundwork in my career as far as a model, modeling for different people, doing all the movies, being the Penthouse Pet of the Year made me a viable product for people like Olivia. So Olivia started painting me, and my husband bought the first painting that she did of me before we were together. And when my husband got a hold of me, he hired all the top artists in the world to paint me, thus my 98 calendar from Heavy Metal by all the different artists. So I became the natural figure, because I'm 6'1" and worth the climb, for his character Fact 2 for the Heavy Metal movie. So it's just kind of a natural evolution that I, being the baddest female on the planet as we speak, would be this incredible character and be here today to talk to the fans and give them a piece of it, because I'm here to share. I love B-movies. They're fun. They're fun to watch. They're crazy. They're campy. They don't always take themselves seriously. There's not this high pressure on the set from the big money producers that each take is like, oh my God, $5,000 wasted because she mispronounced the word. You can just work, have fun, do your takes, go through the jungle with your guns, and be silly.
Do you have lots of your own input?
Yeah, I get to do a lot of my own input. I do all my own hair, I do all my own makeup, I do all my own styling. I am my own agent, I am my own manager, I do my own nails, I do not have a manicurist, I bleach my own mustache, I do everything myself. I'm basically a one-woman show, and I make my own deals, so it's a lot of work.
Like comics. Oh, that's candy. I want candy.
Buy stuff. That's what really happens here. He just buys crap.
Milk chocolate pecan nut party. Patty.
So they're turtle knockoffs.
They're turtle knockoffs. But, you know.
Can you give me some?
Yeah, I'll give you one.
Okay.
Let's just weigh it first. Just weigh it and you can have one. And it's from the Sweet Factory. I'll need it for my symposium, my lecture, if anyone asks me any questions.
On chocolate.
$32? What the?
32 ounces.
Oh.
$1.43.
Oh, that's it.
This one. This two.
You didn't publish mine, did you?
Yeah.
Get out! Where?
It's
hey, it's in the house! Check it out, this is the monkey I drew last year. He published it.
Who did that?
You did this? He's on TV. He's no big artist. Leave the guy alone. He's one cool guy that we interviewed. That's gonna be on the end of it.
Who did that?
I got published. That's my first published work. I did it. Remember last year? Remember they got everybody to draw a monkey? Rob Liefeld, Paul Smith. Well, check that out.
I'm on my way up.
I'm with some serious company, man.
You are, too.
Yeah, man. Hey, where's the wrestler's one?
He's at the very back.
Remember the...
We got Ultimate Warrior.
Ultimate Warrior, where is it?
There he is, right there.
Yeah,
right
beside him.
337.
He's an artist.
Everyone's got
no, he's not.
Mine's just, yes, it is.
Mine's surreal.
Oh no, this is like Matisse. This is like some kid.
What's that? Oops,
sorry, man.
Chris or Josh, are you guys?
Man, thank you very much. I think that's so cool. Can I have this?
Yeah, go ahead.
Thank you. Hi, girls.
I'm on my way.
Come on, let's go.
Okay.
Let's go.
See you.
Follow us in. Track us.
Wow, wow, wow.
Isn't that like a kid? That's so
I'm just joking. Van Gogh type monkey. What do you put about that?
I want to marry a lighthouse. What can I get this Sunday?
Oh, no. I think my pen was borrowed.
I'm sorry,
no problem. Keith, do you have a pen?
Someone from the Western Lessons.
Thank you.
You just had it.
I know. I might have handed it to somebody. It's gone.
Yeah, I mean, these are all his, the rest of his Madman pieces right here.
There's a pen on the floor there.
That's it.
A didgeridoo from Australia. I gotta write that down. Hey, what's going on, man? I just shot a link with Kevin Smith. And did you see those two Mexican girls that come
no,
on?
No, this smoke. Were they sweet? Sharing with you?
Because, no, there's a girl that keeps emailing me at YTV.
That's one of
and
them?
She calls herself the Prof. She apparently sent two tapes back to these two girls, who friends of theirs in Mexico. And those were them. And they were going, aah! But they were going, yeah, the zone and all this. The zone. I was like, what the fuck? From Mexico.
They like you?
They were going crazy. Like they met Fabian or something. Is he popular? Yeah, Fabian or whatever. They were going, yee! And then they walked away and they're going, yee! They're okay, but I mean, it's just from Mexico. From this girl to that, to them, to me here.
Send tapes of the zone.
The zone to Mexico. And then I ran into the mirror.
That's messed up.
That's weird, man.
Just talked to Bobby Chase, and she just looked at my stuff, didn't say anything, and she's like, would you be willing to do a sample page for me? So I'm like, yeah, and she gave me her card and stuff, and I'm supposed to send it to her. And then I talked to, like, Acclaim, and the guy's like, you're there. So he gave me his name and stuff, but like, I don't know how valid that is, because I don't really know the guy. But and then there was Ruben Diaz, he did JLA, he's working for Wildstorm now, editor. He was like, I've got nothing to say, it looks good, but he was just saying how like there's no work and you know, stuff like that, and he doesn't know if it sounded like he didn't think my style was appropriate for the books, the Wildstorm books, so I don't know, you know, it's encouraging, but still kind of tough.
Not too much. I attended a lot more seminars than I thought, and didn't buy terribly much. Just what I bought was just like, I don't know, big 1-2 day spurt. Mostly, I spent my time here learning about this field and meeting professionals, and it was eye-opening, pretty refreshing, and inspired to go next year now. So, got to meet Dark Horse Comics, got my portfolio checked out, so it was pretty cool.
The trip was, well, a good vacation. Wasn't really a good opportunity to try and sell work. I really don't know how to weigh it any other way. It, again, it's just a nice getaway. Dropped off a lot of copies. Probably won't hear feedback for like 6 to 8 months on the story. We heard some feedback on some of the artwork and such. Unfortunately, seems to be not mainstream enough, but that's not what we want to do, so we don't really know how to take that.
That was a good trip. Didn't really get to my success in actually selling the comic to anyone. There's just no time. You're basically one amongst a teeming mass of people also trying to get their work shown. The best bit is to try and find a time and date to actually sit down with an editor one-on-one for more than 5-10 minutes. I got some good feedback on the art, and I know what to improve, things I didn't see before that I do now. The best experience was actually looking at all the original art from books that I've really enjoyed reading, and artwork that I've actually enjoyed. Actually able to hold the pages in my hand, see the art, see the brush strokes, see how they did it. I learned a lot from that. That was actually the most learning. It was also good to connect one-on-one with some of the artists that I've really respected. Actually reduce them from sort of their pantheon of like artists, gods, just to, they're just normal folks just like me. So it's it makes it all seem a lot more reachable as a final goal.
You haven't wasted your life yet. You still have time. Turn back.